welcome you all. Today is, I think, or certainly should be, one of the great commemorations in our public life, Constitution Day. Those are slightly early this year because it actually falls on Saturday, that's the 17th, the day the Constitution was signed. But since we wouldn't want to disturb your weekend and get in the way of intercollegiate football, we're holding it today instead. I'd like to thank our two co-sponsors, Texas Tech Political Science Department, which provided indispensable help in planning this event, and the Remnant Trust, which is presenting, if you don't know it, a counterpart exhibit to today's talk, which will open right after this talk concludes. It will be done about 6:45, and then over at the Museum of Texas Tech in the Sculpture Pod. We'll be having a reception on the occasion of the opening of this exhibit. It consists of 10 classic texts dealing with the Constitution and freedom. So you're all welcome to go there. I hope you do. I also want to thank, especially thank, the CH Foundation that has provided support not only for the lecture, but for the entire series of talks of which this lecture is a part. They're all about freedom in its various dimensions. They all involve counterpart exhibits over at the museum, Remnant Trust texts, and for that reason, the series is called Freedom, Text, and Context. The CH Foundation is a pillar of public life, as I think we all know here in Lubbock, and this event, they're helping us do this event, once again demonstrating that fact. In Federalist 51, James Madison famously explained that the Constitution's design is one that would make ambition counteract ambition. Doing that, he identified the subject of today's talk. A government needs ministers, needs executors, people who carry out its functions, people with knowledge and time to ably discharge its affairs, experts. But these self-same specialists must some way or other be kept from using their necessary authority to invade the rights of citizens who give them their power. How to do this? Well, in part through election, that's the representative process, but also by setting these government officials against themselves through a separation of power. Presumably, they'll still have enough authority to do the job effectively, but without being able to overreach. Is this process of mutual restraint, so artfully devised by the framers of our Constitution, working as it should? Has the government, on the other hand, ceased to be that set of countervailing mechanisms, giving our governors or our public officials just enough but not too much power? Or has it turned into a cozy conspiracy of elites? When I say it that way, I'm almost suggesting it's not true, but maybe it is. A cozy conspiracy of elites who connive together with increasing success to reduce American citizens to subjects. And to the extent that that's happening, what has gone wrong? Has a flaw in the Constitution's architecture finally disclosed itself, or does the problem lie deeper, perhaps in ourselves? We're privileged to have with us this afternoon a man who has given these questions and many others in our public life significant and fruitful thought. Wilfred M. McClay is the G.T. and Libby Blankenship Professor in the History of Liberty at the University of Oklahoma. He is also a senior fellow at the prestigious Ethics and Public Policy Center in Washington and a senior scholar at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, also in Washington. His articles frequently grace the pages of prominent publications of public life, like First Things, The New Atlantis, and The National Review. His books include Religion Returns to the Public Square, Faith and Policy in America, The Maskless Self, Self and Society in Modern America, and most recently, Why Place Matters, Geography and Identity in Modern America. I've had the pleasure of knowing Bill for many years and admiring his work. Joined as we've been in common concern for preserving the richness and intellectual diversity of academic life. I think after hearing what he has to say about our Constitution and how it does or does not balance the rightful claims of experts and citizens, you'll share with me in this deep regard. So without further ado, let me give the floor to Professor Wilfred.
After that introduction, that was wonderful. I don't think I can live up to it. I wanted to say a couple of things about Constitution Day before I start, because I think it's a uniquely American holiday. It's more unique than the 4th of July, which actually is very, you find analogs to the 4th of July in many countries. Many have an Independence Day or sort of a national birthday. But only the United States has a 229-year-old written constitution, the oldest continuities in the world, a document that still shapes its national life. Other countries, such as France can be an example for many comparisons, have had many regimes characterize their nation. So the sense of France as a nation is something distinct from the form of government. But not so for Americans, because we lived since the 1780s under the same regime. A remarkable fact, the significance of which somehow seems to escape us. We revere our Constitution, but we revere it blandly, without troubling ourselves to know very much about it, without reflecting about what it tells us about our national identity. Ties of race, religion, ethnicity, these have never been what bind Americans. We think of diversity as a new issue, recent issue. The conduct of American life is always involved in negotiation of profound differences. Our Constitution, from the beginning, took it as a given that such differences in our human imperfections would generate conflicts. Ambitious individuals, as we see according to Benjamin 51, ambitious individuals would always be with us, along with their dangerous energies and power-hungry interests, which had to be controlled and hopefully channeled. Not merely suppressed, but channeled for the public good. So our Constitution is, disappointingly to some, short on soaring rhetoric. You know, you open up the Constitution and you expect to find,
we hold these truths to be something, 70,
something really magnificent, and instead what you get is essentially a procedural document defining the rules of political engagement. But there's more to it than that, obviously. There's a kind of poetics of the Constitution, if you will. Behind the simple formula of words that we learned in elementary school, like checks and balances, separation of powers, and so on, is a very powerful idea, which Steve actually has sketched out in his introduction. Rather than trying to prevent conflict, which is inevitable given human nature, given our diversity, given our diversity of interests, instead this Constitution would presume the existence of conflict, and try even to institutionalize it as a way of directing it towards the general good. I like to compare it to an internal combustion engine that harnesses the explosions within its chambers to drive the effort of American government.
But for that very reason, it is not conducive to smooth, unanimous actions flowing from centralized power and universal national consensus. Indeed, the craving for centralized unanimity or agreement across the board is one of the things that the Constitution distrusts systemic. And that brings me to my topic for tonight, the authority of experts in a democracy and how the Constitution serves to mediate the inherent tension between those two things, between experts and democracy. Let me begin with a speech that President Barack Obama gave his inaugural address, and a promise that he made in that address, that he would, quote, restore science to its rightful place and wield technology's wonders to raise healthcare's quality and lower its cost. It was a classic political formulation, a lighter-than-aircraft designed to soar over the trade-offs and dichotomies of ordinary life and return to Earth, delivering all things to all people, including a lump of coal to his predecessor. But it raised, without entirely answering the question of what science's rightful place in our democracy is. And I'm not picking on President Obama, and many other people could be picked on in this regard, I'll just keep picking on them. Even in his executive order to lift the Bush administration's ban on federal funding for embryonic stem cell research, President Obama provided a few clues to his thinking on this particular point about science. At the signing ceremony, he said, "Our government in the past has forced what I believe is a false choice between sound science and moral values. But in fact, the two are not inconsistent." Well, I think this is a very reasonable, balanced, and pleasing statement. But unfortunately, it's not hard to think of ways that science has been and can yet be, and almost certainly will be, both entirely sound and entirely oblivious to moral values. That was precisely the point of physicist J. Robert Oppenheimer's famous confession. He being one of the people who worked on the development of the atomic bomb. He said that the pursuit of the atomic bomb had been, quote, "a task too technically sweet. For scientists to resist. You go ahead and do it," Oppenheimer said. "And then you argue about what to do about it only after you've had your technical success." It's kind of a chilling statement, confession. Given the universality of such all too human emotions and motivations, it's foolish to imagine that there won't be many more occasions in the future and present when the false choice that President Obama described is actually an all too real one. It's just in the news lately about science trying to possibly producing an embryo from human skin without man or woman, without eggs. This is sound science, the moral implications of which, who knows? Okay, one really shouldn't, and I'm not, I hope, putting too much weight on the words of a politician. Then again, politicians cannot invent standards of legitimacy when they speak. They have to draw upon and appeal to the ones that are already in place. The president's actions drew upon an exceptionally exalted and uncritical view of science, the scientific authority. One that doesn't hesitate to fling open the public coffers to science while promising it immunity from the indignity of political accountability. It invests enormous faith in the purity of motive of science, the disinterestedness and inherent moral probity of science, and the high-mindedness of disciplinary communities that constitute it. It shows enormous and great deference towards scientific claims of specialized expert knowledge, which by definition is beyond the ken of the layperson. It may show an almost theological faith in science's ability to vanquish all foes and solve all problems, given enough resources. Other realms of human endeavor may require constant supervision, but perhaps not so much science. Such a view of science points in the direction of something not new, but very old, the idea of technocracy, meaning the rule of society by accredited and certified experts, disinterested authorities who turn to an enveloping web of bureaucrats, engineers, civil servants, and other professionals and technicians employed by a vast and all-embracing state apparatus. One could argue that this dream is as old as Plato's Republic, but it's more properly understood as a child of modernity, the lofty dream of philosophes and utopians, such as the Marquis de Condorcet and Auguste Comte, Professor Frank Ward in America, who believed that the intelligibility of the world and the limitless capacity of human reason allowed the methods of science to be extended to all aspects of life, including the ordering of public affairs and politics. This idea, in full or part, has had many exponents over the years, even in democratic America. It's informed the shape taken by the professions, medical, legal, scientific, scholarly, that established themselves as bastions of expertise in the last decades of the 19th century. It has a particular attraction to those who dislike or distrust the activity of democratic politics, with its rough and tumble clash of competing interests, ideologies, passions, and susceptibility to corruption and demagoguery and self-interest and dishonesty. How much better to decide thorny and divisive issues by reference to panels of accredited experts whose training and commitments embody the breadth and depth of disinterested intellect, rather than the imperfections of the democratic process and all its messiness. Much of the many-faceted progressive movement of the early 20th century reflected this same belief. Although the progressive movement drew heavily on the deep reservoirs of the country's Protestant moral passion, it blended these passions with an essentially technocratic ideal, the application of disinterested social research generated by scholars trained in the sciences of administration and government in state universities, and applied by disinterested and uncorrupted public officials, including city managers, who would be appointed rather than elected, therefore rendered immune to political pressures. All of this would lead to ever-improving government. No place was this ideal more fully realized than in the state of Wisconsin, where the University of Wisconsin was consciously envisioned as an embodiment of the social intelligence of the state. Wisconsin's president, Charles Van Hise, in 1904, stated he would never be content until the beneficent influence of the university reaches every family in the state. You hear that as a beneficent thing or as an ominous thing, reaching every family in the state. In the wake of the Second World War, the so-called liberal consensus seemed to be a triumphant iteration of the same idea, although in a less moralistic key. President John F. Kennedy gave the commencement address at Yale in 1962 and said the following: "What is at stake in our economic decisions today is not some grand warfare of rival ideologies, but the practical management of a modern economy. What we need is not labels and cliches, but more discussion of sophisticated technical questions involved in keeping economic machinery moving ahead." So Kennedy essentially presents the technocratic vision, and instead of ending his speech with the usual inspirational uplift that you find in similar commencement speeches, he advised the graduates to take your part in the solution of the problems that pour upon us requiring sophisticated technical judgment. Not exactly a rip-roaring conclusion, but what he was doing was ushering them into the ranks of the technocracy. Okay, well, this strain of technocratic rationality has not been the whole story of American politics, as we all know. There's a long and colorful history of resistance to it. President Andrew Jackson, for one, was notoriously suspicious of experts and all claims of experts. He defended the principle that public offices should be rotated among party supporters, according to the spoils system, as a way of sustaining the nation's Republican ideals, because effective performance in public office required no special training, no special intelligence. It's something any person could do. So rotation in office would ensure the federal bureaucracy did not become a parasitic class of corrupt civil servants who were set apart from the people and could make hay out of the monopolies of control of special knowledge. His sentiments marked the beginnings of what would become the populist strain in American political culture. Now, it's always been easy to dismiss the outlook of Jackson and those who come in his wake. I mean, those of us who work in academia are particularly prone to do so. Richard Hofstadter looked at Andrew Jackson and saw in him what he called the anti-intellectualism of American life. But even though I am myself an academic, let me say a word in favor of the populism of Jackson. He did, after all, stand, he's one of the ethical figures in the democratization of American culture. What we call the Age of Jackson saw a substantial expansion of political participation, extension of the suffrage, and a broadening and quickening of general economic opportunity. It was a dramatic affirmation of the worth of the common person. His example, the example of Jackson, testifies to the fact that democracy itself stands in tension with expertise. And democracy insists that the expertise be accountable to the populace and to broadly social and political considerations, which is precisely why, I return to my opening, the question of science's proper place is a vexed question, perhaps more vexed than the president made out in his comments. In any event, the status of experts seems so lofty and uncontroversial in Kennedy's speech was soon to receive a rude shock from which it has never entirely recovered. 5 years later, in 1967, the social critic Paul Goodman wrote of his dismay when teaching a course at the New School for Social Research in New York on professionalism. And he brought in professionals and experts in a variety of fields, architects, doctors, engineers, and the like, whom he brought to speak to his class on professionalism. His students, too much to his surprise, were contemptuous of these experts. Goodman was not. Goodman, even though Goodman was a radical and critic of American culture, he had an old-fashioned respect for craftsmanship and for the work of true experts and their dedication to professional ideals. Not Goodman's students. They suspected the professionals. They saw them as mechanisms of social control, tools for the consolidation of power, the co-optation of knowledge. This was the 60s. So, experts were not just passionate truth seekers bound by the integrity of their oaths. They were liars and mystifiers, mainly interested in lining their pockets and protecting their own turf. This hostile view of experts turned out to be more than an isolated phenomenon. And it had particular resonance, including in the university. This populism of the left received support from a surge of anti-professional scholarship in field after field. Psychiatry was an especially juicy target, as did any field having to do with human sexuality. The title of Barton Lenstein's 1977 book, The Culture of Professionalism, deftly captured the emerging view, which has placed the modern university at the center of a great cultural transformation. by which the rising middle class established and then defended its turf and pursued its hegemonic class interests. Well, there's much in this critique that was vastly overblown, patently self-indulgent, and I won't, I don't know that you need to detail that, so it's obvious to you. Much that I think has been enduringly damaging to the academic enterprise, which withers and dies if it can't present at least some possibility of objective standards and civil discourse. But there was an important grain of truth in this. The authority of experts took a beating over the past 40-some years, partly because the idea toward which such authority tended, the idea that expert knowledge could be amassed and distributed in an entirely disinterested and neutral way, that was the core of the technocratic dream, was deeply mistaken and subversive, I would argue, in any meaningful perception of political democracy. The suspicion has endured and found unpredictable ramifications. For example, it saw the emergence in the mid-60s of public choice economic theory, which insists that all considerations of public policy include in them the recognition that government is itself a kind of interest group, and thereby flatly reflects the technocratic claim of being disinterested. The thriving field of economic study to the public choice economy. So we find ourselves in a fitting moment to reflect freshly on the uneasy status of expertise in a democratic society. It's an unavoidable tension, because the two things, expertise and democracy, pull in opposite directions. Expertise locates authority in specialized knowledge, professional certification, based on extensive education, rigorous standards of evidence, operating in highly exclusive, self-correcting communities of peer review. Democracy, on the other hand, tends toward the widest possible affirmation of the competence of every man and woman, irrespective of their education, simply as a function of their status as human beings and citizens. The two principles can coexist, of course. They may even serve as correctives to one another, but they cannot easily be fenced in or content with anything short of predominance. So they're at loggerheads. And there's always these chronic, this mutual distrust. Let me say a few words about expertise per se, because expertise is not a new thing. It's always been a feature of human associations. Why? Because it's an outgrowth of the division of labor itself and distinctions of rank and function that are natural to even the most rudimentary human associations. One thinks, for example, of the social role of priests, shamans, midwives, and the like, and the specialized knowledge that comes with those roles in society. But of course, expertise, as we understand it today, is a product of the modern world. The conditions that gave rise to our immense complexity and social differentiation that had no precedent earlier. The engine of this transformation was what the sociologist Max Weber called rationalization, the tendency to subject ever more fine divisions of life, parts of life, to impersonal calculations of their cost and benefit, rather than evaluate them by reference to custom, tradition, precedent, religion, or affective ties. Rationalization. Precisely because of rationalization in the Weberian sense. And these disorienting conditions of modern society that it brings about, that we place such a high premium on expert knowledge. Especially, and I quote here from a leading historian of professions, Thomas Askew, especially when it comes stamped with the special authority that organized communities of practitioners who police each other's opinions and create something like a consensus of the competent. Consensus of the competent. These words imply kindly trust and respect. But Weber is those of you who have read through to the end of Weber's Protestant Ethic and Spirit of Capitalism know his vision of modernity is bleak. He describes an iron cage of rationalization. The pathos of his work, and he is an enormously moving figure this way, it rose out of the contrast becomes this unsparing depiction of the degraded condition of rationalization, unbridled rationalization, which seemed to be leading inexorably towards a kind of a diminution of the human race. Technocrats saw future roses in sunlight. He saw, I quote, a polar night of icy darkness, of mechanized petrifaction, embellished with a sort of convulsive self-importance. A world, and here's some famous words, a world of specialists without spirit, sensualists without heart, of humanity becoming a nullity that imagines it's achieved a level of civilization never before achieved. So Weber's vision, even if he underwrote the technocratic enterprise, ought to make us hesitant about endorsing a regime of experts, even if it could be made to work as advertised. And that last statement, even if it could be made to work as advertised, is perhaps a questionable statement itself. Perhaps anything short of a radical alteration of human nature itself would make such success unlikely. To be sure, it's inconceivable that we could make sensible judgments about highly technical issues, such as structural engineering, or nuclear power, or epidemiological danger, or climate alteration, without recurring to the judgment of experts. We consult such experts, and we are right to do so. I mean, be firm on that. We rely on the statistics gathered by the Bureau of Labor Statistics to make judgments about unemployment, and gathered by the Census Bureau to make judgments about the allocation of resources in our country. We're right to do that too. Yet, the fact remains that we are fools if we take these judgments and these data on simple faith without considering their source, their internal consistency, and their adequacy in the larger context of politics or decision making. No one should take the word expert as an open sesame. Nowhere is this problem more obviously and glaringly visible than the use of expert witnesses in courts of law. It goes without saying that there are instances such as forensic reports and DNA analyses in which the testimony of experts is essential and has to be regarded as utterly reliable, and the standards of accuracy are relatively objective and transparent. But there are other examples, such as the notorious forms of psychiatric expert testimony attendant on the abuse excuse that may be vaguer and less transparent, more subject to common sense skepticism and challenge. And in cases where both parties in a court case have particularly deep pockets, there may be hired done expert witnesses whose expertise is less firmly established than the predictability of their testimony, or dueling experts whose views cancel one another out, thus throwing the matter back on a judge or jury. Such a judge or jury must learn to possess, in a very real sense, an expertise beyond expertise, an ability to judge and rank claims of expertise against a standard that is impossible to describe, but impossible to do without. Might be seen as what we call common sense. This in turn raises another consideration about falling outside of Weber's iron cage, the situation in which the putative experts turn out not to be experts at all. In this case, Exhibit A, I may offend somebody in this audience, but I may please others by this example, the entire profession of economics. No social scientific field has been more confident with scientific accuracy. None has been filled with a greater sense of self-importance. Then came the global financial crisis of 10 years ago. The beginning of the pandemic. And a great and general humbling ensued, at least for a while. Why, said Queen Elizabeth, no less, who was not an accomplice, why did no one see this crisis coming? She addressed the question to the prophets, who probably assembled a panel of experts under the auspices of the Royal Academy, the British Academy, and offered the following answer to her question. I can't do the British accent, but it really would be quite appropriate here. Everyone seemed to be doing their own job properly on its own merit. And according to standard measures of success, they were often doing it well. The failure was to see how collectively this added up to a series of interconnected imbalances over which no single authority had jurisdiction. It was basically a failure of the collective imagination of many bright people. Does that clear it all up for you? What I think it is clearly, well, this is a failure of expertise itself. Or better named, it made the ways of certifying it in that field. How did such a failure occur, given all these professional safeguards that we had? Well, I think we can learn a great deal about this from a remarkable and honest confession by the economist Robert Shiller, who had advised the Federal Reserve Bank of New York up to 2004, but kept quiet about the dangerous housing bubble he thought he saw developing. Shiller said, "While I warned about the bubbles, I did so gently, and I felt vulnerable expressing such perky views. Deviating too far from the consensus leaves one feeling potentially ostracized from the specialized group, with the risk that one may be terminated." How about that? So the communities of the competent, in Thomas Hasson's terms, may be communities of the complacent or communities of the conforming. What Shiller describes is a situation that was rendered intellectually and morally dangerous, not by the fact of expert consensus itself, by the illegitimate way the consensus was sustained, by the fear, and he suggests a self-interested fear of being fired, that dissenting views could not be safely aired. We see this scenario enacted again and again with regard to important issues, a great public moment in which powerful voices and lazy journalists declare that all the experts are in agreement and the debate is over. Nothing is more corrosive of the true spirit of science and truth-seeking than this spirit of bullying dogmatism. The discipline of economics is, to some extent, paying the price for this, as our best. We may see similar prices paid in other fields as well. Nicholas Wade of the New York Times commented on the Shiller case the following way. If the brightest minds on Wall Street got suckered by groupthink into believing housing prices would never fall, what other policies founded on consensus wisdom could be waiting to come unravel? Global warming, you say? You mean it might be harder to model climate change 20 years ahead than house prices 4 years ahead? Now, Wade is painting with a broad brush, but what he says here, the general point he's made, is hardly implausible. The entire edifice of expert knowledge is in danger of a damaging loss of credibility. We all have a stake in this. And confirming that sense of shaky foundations is a valuable recent book anybody here who is a professor should read. Michelle Lamont's book, How Professors Think, a careful inside sociological study of the central institution, arguably, of academic life, the peer review panel. Lamont is a careful, methodical researcher who studies a discrete attempt to get inside the black box, a procedure that's rendered very mysterious, maybe more mysterious than it needs to be. But the current practice of peer review does not come off well in her analysis. If the choice of experts serving on allegedly expert panels suffered from the absence of enduring professional canon, then maybe the disdain of Paul Goodman's students at the New School was justified. perhaps we are in at least some disciplines. I'm afraid the humanities, because where I live are among them. We are edging towards Will Rogers' famous definition of an expert. You all heard this? An expert is a man 50 miles from home with a briefcase. I don't have a briefcase. In fact, one of the most intriguing books of recent years, a book called The Wisdom of Crowds, makes the surprising case that the judgments of ordinary people, when they're properly aggregated, those opinions, are often superior to those of experts. Not every crowd is wise in the author's claim. I'm avoiding the author's name, but I can't pronounce it. Cyril Wiecki. But those possessing sufficient diversity, those groups, those crowds, possessing sufficient diversity and independence to guard against groupthink, and a means, a proper way of aggregating individual opinions into a group judgment, can often outperform the judgments of experts. The internet is an incomparable tool for aggregating vast amounts of information drawn from highly disparate sources, sources not even known to one another, and doing it more or less spontaneously. A familiar example will demonstrate the point. In the midst of the 2004 presidential campaign, CBS News' Dan Brander presented the country with documents purporting to cast doubt on President Bush's service in the Texas Air National Guard. Well, this got ordinary bloggers all around the country working on the problem. They were not experts. They did not know one another. Unlike the very experienced and seasoned staff of CBS News, they were not part of a community of competence. But they had a vast set of idiosyncratic skills and experience related to typewriters and typefaces being used in particular ways, in particular government agencies, at particular times. And by means of internet blogs, they were able to quickly assemble a devastating case that the documents were forgeries. Similar scenarios have been repeated numerous times, and it's been increasingly difficult for mainstream reporters and politicians to present sensational reports or give highly edited versions of speeches or draft opaque legislation that will not undergo instantaneous scrutiny by non-experts. So, what is the future of expertise in our democracy? Clearly, given the immense and growing technological and cultural complexity of the world we inhabit, we're not going to be able to do it without the aid of experts, nor should we. Technocratic rule and populism are not the only two alternatives. Far preferable to either is an order that respects the claims of both democracy and expertise, without denying the tension between them, and that I think is where the United States Constitution comes in. That is its role, to mediate that tension. Can we make useful generalizations about the rightful place and limits of expertise? Can we pinpoint the reasons why experts fail and find means of guarding against such failures in the future? Surely the example of the financial crisis and the economists offers many clues in this regard. First, it suggests the crucial importance of keeping diversity of opinion and perspective alive in the disciplinary communities, alive in this university and in every university. Or to introduce diversity, in some cases, for the first time in memory. It suggests how imperative it is for the health of the whole that alternative opinion not be shut out peremptorily, and that the dominant paradigms and normal science of the day, he kept using and wielding a tyrannizing control over discourse. That's first. Second, we need to be attentive to the larger context within which expert knowledge is made meaningful. The British economist Robert Skidelsky has blamed the failure of the economic profession on its overweening scientific pretensions, its abstract and overly mathematical account of human behavior. Priding itself precisely on its prowess as a predictive science, economics must now be the pro. Its current intellectual limitations are, in his view, traceable back to the training of economists in the universities, in which broadly based study of the philosophical, moral, historical dimensions of human existence, sort of thanks to Ewald's present quote, is almost entirely neglected in favor of sophisticated technical training, which reduces the discipline's subject matter to, and I quote Skidelsky here, a mechanical world of interacting robots. But most important of all is the insight embedded in the United States Constitution. It is vitally important that the contingency and vulnerability of even the most expert knowledge not be forgotten. And that we learn not to expect too much from experts, or get inordinately offended with them when they fail us, and they will. It is not only their fault, but ours, if we forget that life is full of risks, and there's always a broader context within which narrow expertise loses its grip and ceases to be authoritative. In a society awash in all manner of expert claims, we need to cultivate a judge's or jury's skill in evaluating those claims, to be as expert as we can in the evaluation of experts, and accept responsibility for the chips when they fall. In other words, experts should have a voice in our democracy, and a resounding and respected one, but only then. As James Q. Wilson, great political scientist, said, experts should be on tap, but not on top. They cannot speak ex cathedra, and are expected to be automatically funded, let alone automatically obeyed, merely for the letters after their name, or the sheepskins on their wall, or the professional associations to which they belong. They also have to persuade. They have to speak a public language, an accessible language, break themselves up to the democratic bar, and make themselves patiently and respectfully heard in a way that passes muster with their fellow citizens. An impenetrably technocratic top-down solution to social or economic problems that does not meet that standard, and does not seek the informed consent of the government, is unacceptable because it's a betrayal of the idea of a democratic republic built on the concept of self-rule. However, democratic is about intention. So, to repeat again, we should not deny the power of specialized knowledge in all spheres of inquiry. That would be foolish and suicidal. But we should not exaggerate that power and allow it to colonize our lives and negate our democratic self-ruling potential. We should never forget self-knowledge is a means, specialized knowledge is a means and not an end. There are no technocratic experts in the art of living, only flawed individuals finding their own way. That is as it should be. That is what it means to keep expertise in its rightful place. As Max Weber understood, in the end, the bureaucratization of knowledge and the radicalization of the world lead to a barren knowledge that is not really knowledge, because it's a knowledge of everything except the proper ends to which knowledge should be put. It views the world in splinters and fragments, and insensibly but surely robs human life of its own spontaneous energy and grace and freedom. We need to be aware of that possibility, and be wary of the promise that the application of expert knowledge will invariably improve our lives. It isn't necessarily so. This is the inner meaning of G.K. Chesterton's famous saying, if a thing is worth doing, it's worth doing badly. You hear that? If a thing is worth doing, it's worth doing badly. It's worth doing badly, at least as I interpret it. Others may interpret it saying differently. I interpret it this way. It's worth doing badly, anything worth doing, because the most important thing of all is not that one does the thing perfectly well, but that one does it and does it oneself. These are the things that are ends in themselves, to which the application of self-conscious technique let alone technique being wielded by others, just being dead. One can sing badly, worship badly, make love badly, eat and drink badly, and vote badly. But no one in his right mind wants to yield those functions to others more accomplished or obsessed over how an expert would rate his performance. What could such a judgment possibly mean? Whose life is it anyway? Faced with such considerations, expertise needs to lay down its load and fall silent, since of such things it really has nothing to say. So the conflict between expertise and democracy is intrinsic, but conflict is an inescapable part of political life. The notion that we're going to achieve some kind of unanimity around all issues of moment is something that the Constitution wisely denounces and wisely seeks to accommodate the diversity that will always be characteristic of any healthy human society. We all have different interests, and I mean interests in the economic sense as well as the intellectual sense. We all have legitimate, but different and divergent interests. We always will. It is the creative insight of our Constitution that such conflict cannot be avoided and should not. It need not be invariably destructive, and it can be channeled toward the common good and toward the flourishing of the individual person, both at the same time. But to live under our form of government means that even experts have to sometimes answer the question, says who? Thank you.
Will you take some questions?
No, absolutely not. Of course, be delighted.
Floor is open.
Sure.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have two things I'd like you to comment on. The technocratic view seems to believe that there's an objective answer to all questions, that there are no subjective questions or subjective answers. And it also, you mentioned that economists treat people like robots. Gets back to the same thing. So if there is free will, it seems that there are going to be things that the experts can't tell us what to do.
Yes, I agree. And even if they could, there is an element of the freedom that goes with being a self-governing person, of what I think is the core of democracy, that's denied by technocratic rule. Even if the experts do, our freedom should also entail, in areas that don't endanger public health, there are exceptions, of course, but we should have the right to send censor. I'm going to eat that tribe fat. Triglyceride. Trans fats. That's what I'm drinking. Trans fat. If I want, I have these choices that are intrinsic to my freedom. I shouldn't have to order my life as if I was living in a forest of orange cones, always under construction. It's the way it is in Oklahoma, by the way. Everything's always under construction. So I'm not sure there's anything we don't heartily agree about. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Quick question. Related to the role of public funding in science.
Public
funding of science in general. Is there, I'll give an example as an economist. Piketty got all the funding for his own research on inequality. Inequality, probably the most normative topic we can find. I mean, by providing public funding, you're also providing kind of a sanction, a sanctification for a certain strand of research. How does this play in undermining the fundamentals by Constitution?
Oh, well, that's a very interesting and rich question. I mean, the first thing I think of, something a lot of people don't know, everybody knows that when Eisenhower left the presidency, he gave a farewell address, which he warned of the military industrial complex, right? Everybody knows that. What people don't know about is what he said immediately afterwards. He warned about the federal funding of science and the prospect of the federal government could come to dominate the funding of all science, and science being increasingly a corporate undertaking that you couldn't have this sort of single adventurer scientist to set up his or her lab and work on their own. It was impossible that modern science could be conducted outside of highly hierarchical, organized, corporatized, heavily capitalized laboratories. That the introduction of federal funding was something he regarded with great alarm, that there simply would be very difficult to guard against ways in which funding would reflect policy and vice versa. They said rather than coming out of the policy, instead of policies following on after the scientific basic research. So I think it's an intrinsic problem. And I think the best way to address a thing is to go back to Federalist 51 is to have as robust as possible a system of peer review and accountability built into the process. The more that the public purse is being demanded to support scientific research, the more accountability, the more layers of accountability there should be, the greater effectiveness of mechanisms of peer review. You know, there have been some terrifying studies, at least to me, terrifying, of the inadequacy of peer review in scientific journals. I don't know if any of you have more specific information about that, but 30-40% of articles in major scientific journals that have faulty research, faulty conclusions, and where peer review is clearly failed. I think it's Michelle Lamont's book is very good on this. So I think that's one area to address this. That there's the extent that there's a demand on the public purse that we need to be ever stricter and more diverse kinds of controls, instead of simply relying on one rather tight, rather cozy scientific community to provide that evaluation. That's a great question. Yes, sir.
I'm going to address back here so they can hear me, okay?
Okay, yeah.
My question is, what do you see, I'm going to our overall theme, what do you see as the future of Western civilization? And I would like to preface it by this statement. In 2003, Herb Myers did a DVD called The Siege of Western Civilization. In that, he points out that in order for our civilization to perpetuate itself, the birth rate has to be 2.1. And he points out in Europe that the birth rate in those countries is something like France, Italy, under Yugoslavia, is 1.7, 1.8, 1.6. United States at that time, 2003, it was exactly 2.1, according to moderates. That was before we had terrorism. So I go back to the question, what do you see as the future of Western civilization?
You know, why don't you ask me a big question? I mean, a little penny answer. Well, let me say a couple of things. I always feel a responsibility when I'm speaking in a setting like this with students who are looking ahead many more years than you and I are, not to be too gloomy, not to, particularly about things that we can't really know. So even if I had the deepest and darkest pessimism in my heart, I probably wouldn't say it in this setting. And there's a serious side to that, that answer, which is that I think that I do believe in free will, that, and that I do believe in the kind of problem of self-fulfilling prophecy. That is, if we conclude that all is lost and behave as if we believe all is lost, then all will be lost. So I think there's an element of just the responsibility that I have as a teacher to provide within the limits of honesty. And I'm not going to paint this whole person, my little pony's future for the students. But within the limits of honesty, to give them something sustaining, something that they can build a realistic hope on. Okay, now, the main hope that I have for Western civilization is the fact that it's almost never the case that trends continue uninterrupted. See, if you extrapolate the demographic trends that you described into the not very long-range future, you do have a demographic catastrophe. I mean, the demographic catastrophe, in some respects, maybe already upon us. You can't immediately sort of produce 21-year-olds when people decide, okay, we want to start reproducing. We've got a tremendous amount of ground to make. And it remains to be seen whether Angela Merkel's idea that you can bring in a million immigrants from the Middle East to provide labor force for Germany will work and still have a Germany that is Germany in the end. So there are terrific problems if you simply extrapolate ahead into the future. I'm worried. I'm concerned about that particular issue. I'm concerned that we have so little regard for the consequences of our innovations in biomedical science, of the way in which we are changing what it means to be human without having thought about it, without reflecting about it. J. Robert Oppenheim, for example, I think is very opposite. People aren't being drawn by technically sweet problems in their laboratories, and the achievements that get funded and get the recognition and that are exciting and interesting. But we lack the ability, because of the structure of our expert knowledge, to force them to stand back and say, what the hell am I doing? What are the implications of what I'm doing? Moral society in terms of the sustainable human future. So I think.
Should I withdraw my question?
No. It's out there. No, it's out there. But I think the main source of hope is the fact that we do not live in a deterministic universe. We have freedom. And that is, I think, at the core of what Western civilization is about. We recognize constraints on human action in the world, but we also recognize the possibility of our creativity, our imagination. Tocqueville, the great French traveler in America, wrote Democracy in America, has a wonderful, wonderful image of the conclusion of democracy. I want you to run out and read it. But he lambastes people who are deterministic, who think that the fate of the human race is determined by material forces that they can't touch and can't control. This is what he says. He says, it is true that around every pen is drawn a fatal circle, beyond which he can't go. I can't leap off of the Empire State or fly over to Chrysler. There are certain things I just not going to be able to do. But, he goes on to say, within this circle, I am powerful and free. As it is with individuals, so it is with me. So I think we have a terrific set of problems closing in. We have a remarkable lack of awareness of what we need to do to address those problems. There's a certain lack of consensus about what to do to address them. It's as if we're still a bit asleep. I think we will wake up. I hope we will wake up in time. How's that?
You know, I think right now, we're actually fighting World War III. World War II wasn't a world war. It was Europe and the South Pacific. But with terrorism, we indeed have a world war. Simultaneously, fighting World War III, we're also fighting Civil War number two, as between the opposite end of the spectrum on politics, religion, morals.
It's a very fractious time, I agree.
We're fighting two wars simultaneously.
Well, I don't know whether I will go all the way with you on that, but I would say we are living in a very fractious and divided time. We've lived in such times before. It doesn't prove anything, except that it is possible to pull out. And it may be some external events. The sweet meteor of death, that thing on the internet. maybe something less catastrophic. You know, this is a rather feeble example, but I'm going to use it anyway. Anybody who's ever read much in the history of American attitudes in the 1930s knows that there was tremendous reluctance on the part of Americans to involve ourselves in the rise of these murderous regimes in Russia, in Europe, Hitler, Mussolini, and so on. And in much of the West, in Britain, you know, in the Oxford Club resolution about I will not go to war for my country, has been down in me. But just concentrating on this country, we did everything we could to stay out in Pearl Harbor. And overnight, a fiercely divided country became fiercely united. That's a hell of a way to do it, I think. I'm just saying, sometimes external events can change the calculus dramatically. All of that extrapolating into the future looks pretty useless. So we live in a world of events and contingencies. That's important to remember. Not to think that you can develop an algorithm that's going to tell you exactly where things go. That's what my crystal ball says. yes, sir.
Does the Constitution endorse access to healthcare and injury?
Oh, access. I don't think it concerns itself with that issue one way or the other. It doesn't deny it. It doesn't guarantee it. It's certainly not in the Bill of Rights. You might say some people might extrapolate it from the preamble, from promoting the general welfare. But that's a bit of a stretch, you know. So, yeah, that doesn't mean that the fact it's not in the Constitution doesn't mean it's off the table as policy. It's just not necessarily constitutional. Yes?
I believe that from whatever gets going on now, that we have broken into tax perks in our trying to govern we the people about things that we don't need to govern about.
Well, I think it's a very...
If that was true, then they could be handling the war situation, the things that they need to be handling. We can handle, the women can handle if they didn't have abortions or not, or health care, if you want health care. None of that should even be involved in our government.
Well, I think there are a lot of people
who... I just think that they are so overstepping their bounds. Our liberty, our freedom.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that technocracy takes the view that the big picture, which only the experts can have, I'm just trying to, I'm not trying to defend it, I'm just trying to explain the mentality. It is for me, for example, one of my favorite examples of this is diet, because I'm thinking about diet. I could be forced to be free, as Dr. Hoffman says, by having somebody who really understands nutrition and knows the flips of his items. And I'm going to take control of your diet. And from now on, you're going to eat all the toast, all 24 hours a day.
Is it individual person?
Well, yeah, but this will not be.
It's not what a nutritionist or whatever. It shouldn't be up to your government to make you.
What I'm saying is that there is a view that people are better off. Many people can't decide things for themselves. They need help. I'm distracted by you.
One last question.
The Constitution tries to guard these sorts of things.
Yeah.
Constitution is, as I said in the beginning, it's a procedural document. It's not a comprehensive plan for society. Its main purpose is to control the parts of the government by putting them at odds with one another, and to protect the negative liberties of individuals. That is, by negative liberties, I mean freedom from the government telling you what to do, that you Congress shall make no law respecting religion, freedom of speech, and so on. Yes?
From a very general to more specific example, we as citizens elect our officials, they go to the legislators, they pass the bills to allocate money to various functions, the executive signs off, and we get government operating. So when an entity hires experts, and now for the specific example, we have a circumstance where it's very good to have children vaccinated before they enter their schooling. A small minority will proclaim this is an infringement of my freedom. The vast majority of experts say, no, this is good to have kids vaccinated. But there'd be a few out there, scientists say, no, that science is wrong. So we have a judgment factor here of who is correct, who is not correct. And is it the position to say that my freedom is being violated by the forcing of a vaccination, going against the fabric of the Constitution? So this whole process has involved the election, the legislature, the approval of the executive, the hiring of experts, and getting a vast majority of the opinion of that community to so say this is the route we should go. Isn't this the essence of the constitutional democracy?
I missed the punchline.
The fact that we have experts saying this is what should be followed, the legislative branch hired them, the executive is blessing it and say kids cannot come into school unless they're vaccinated.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's the essence, as long as you include the fact that in some way the legislators are accountable to the voters. They are held accountable, and if the voters decide we're not down with this, and they are responsive, or they don't get reelected.
But so often people say, this is an example of our freedoms are being eroded in bad science, but it's good science and some minority
people. People can say a lot of things, and that's what freedom of speech is all about. I think that doesn't mean we have to. No, the government has to make hard decisions. Vaccination is a very good example, where it particularly when it's a question of public health, it can be, it's still a debatable point. We're talking about one child who is isolated from other children, there's no infectious possibility, no epidemiological considerations involved. But if there's public health involved, you have to make a decision that that child is going to come in contact with other children, that there is no point in having a public health regime at all if you don't vaccinate everybody. So I agree with you, but I think that's an instance of the kind of hard choices that governments have to make in situations where you don't have a universal consensus. But experts can't have the total and final say on every issue. There has to be some kind of democratic buy-in, or else we're really not doing that.
I guess what's an example of where the experts have overridden the government, the representatives? Do you have an example of one that you would say this is an example?
In public health, nothing comes to my mind.
Anywhere.
Well, the states that have, this comes to my states that revoked Common Core. My own state, Oklahoma, adopted Common Core, and then the legislature forced it to be revoked, and the school system voted the whole thing. Break it.
That was a vote. There wasn't a Democrat saying, you will do this, and there was no vote.
No, I'm not sure what you're asking for, but I think maybe I need to move on. Maybe we can talk
about it. I think we probably should. Oh. You're free to come to the reception over at the museum. We can continue the conversation there. It's going to begin at 7 o'clock. I welcome you all, and let's give our speaker a hand.